And if you would go ahead and take your Bibles and open to the book of Genesis chapter 50. Genesis chapter 50. We're going to be looking at verses 15 to 21 as we come to the grand finale of our journey through the book of Genesis. This Sunday, the title of the message is God's Hidden Hand. But before we go way back thousands of years to this culmination of the book of Genesis and what was going on with Joseph and the descendants of Israel, we're going to go back a little closer to more recent history, to a significant day in American history, March 7th, 1965, which would be a day and a turning point in U.S. history. It was on that day that 25-year-old John Lewis led 600 marchers over the Edmund Pettus Bridge in Selma, Alabama. They were petitioning for the right of all black citizens to be able to vote. Governor George Wallace had ordered state troopers, saying to use whatever measures necessary to prevent a march. Nonetheless, the march went out, beginning at Brown Chapel AME Church, and the event would be broadcasted on news channels across the country. As the group approached the steel-arched bridge over the Alabama River, which is still there today, the marchers could see the name of a Confederate general and a grand dragon of the Alabama KKK, Edmund Pettus, staring back at them. When they reached the crest of the bridge, they saw trouble on the other side, a wall of state troopers with white helmets and billy clubs, and behind them were deputies on horseback. Dozens of white spectators had gathered around waving Confederate flags. Nonetheless, they marched forward down the thin sidewalk of the bridge, and they stopped just about 50 feet before the authorities. "It would be detrimental to your safety to continue this march," Major John Cloud called out from his bullhorn. "This is an unlawful assembly. You have to disperse. You are ordered to disperse. Go home or to your church. This march will not continue." "Mr. Major," replied Williams, "I would like to have a word. Can we have a word?" "I've got nothing further to say to you," Cloud answered. What happened that day shook the nation. The troopers, with gas masks and clubs, advanced. They pushed back Lewis and Williams. They knocked marchers to the ground. They struck them with sticks. Clouds of tear gas were mixed with screams of terrified marchers and also the cheers of reveling bystanders. Deputies on horseback charged ahead, swinging clubs and whips, even rubber tubing that was wrapped with barbed wire, driving gasping men, women, and children back over the bridge. Protesters, though, refused to fight back. They refused to retaliate in any way. Television viewers watched on in horror as they witnessed women, children, and elderly who posed no physical threat being struck, trampled, and dragged about. The event quickly became known as Bloody Sunday. Many who were apathetic to the plight of black Americans were now finding themselves appalled. Sympathizers would stage sit-ins, traffic blockades, and demonstrations in solidarity with voting rights marchers. By August 6, 1965, that same year, President Johnson had signed the Voters' Rights Act. What one group meant for evil that day, God used for the good of a nation. A turning point, an awakening, a transition. This is a picture from 2010. I had to put an arrow pointing to me because you might not recognize me. I had hair back then and glasses. And we were on a journey called the Sankofa Journey. It's a journey that you can also join in on. It's still being sponsored and led by our denomination, the Covenant, Evangelical Covenant, and they take this journey a few different times of years. And when you go on this journey, it's 3 days as you literally go to places in the civil rights movement to look at history. The word Sankofa means looking back in order to move forward. And it's done in a way that is very balanced. There's extremism on both sides today, and I am thankful that we've been doing this long before that extremism ever set in. They pair you up with someone who is a Christ follower, most likely from the denomination. I was paired up with a gentleman that became a good friend, Curtis Evans. He stands to the left of me, and he was able to share with me his own journey. He graduated from Harvard with a PhD. He is a professor at the Chicago University. He specializes in Black American religion, and he was able to talk about the opportunities, but the continued challenges. The word Sankofa means looking back to move forward, so he's looking back at how far we've come and what things used to be like, and indeed we have it, made incredible advances. And also looking as a church outside of the political realm, what can we do to be able to continue to be aware of the challenges that still exist for many of our brothers and sisters in Christ? And so how can we continue to build upon and continue to take good and build good out of what once was meant for evil? How can we continue to move forward in productive ways, redeeming these situations? As we come to the end of Genesis, we're given a culminating revelation. God's hidden hand is redeeming even the evil intentions of humanity. Jacob has died, and Joseph and his brothers have carried Jacob's body back to the promised land, where he would be buried in a tomb by Mamre with his grandfather and father, Abraham and Isaac and other family members. And then Joseph and his brothers returned back to Egypt, and they're living in Goshen. Now with Jacob gone, his brothers begin to fear that Joseph might want to retaliate. And this is where we pick up in our story, in Genesis 50, 15 to 21. It says, "When Joseph's brothers saw that their father was dead, they said, 'What if Joseph holds a grudge against us and pays us back for all the wrongs we did to him?' So they sent word to Joseph, saying, 'Your father left these instructions before he died. This is what you are to say to Joseph: I ask you to forgive your brothers the sins and the wrongs they committed in treating you so badly. Now please forgive the sins of the servants of the God of your father.' When their message came to him, Joseph wept. His brothers then came and threw themselves down before him. 'We are your slaves,' they said. But Joseph said to them, 'Don't be afraid. Am I in the place of God? You intended to harm me, but God intended it for good, to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives. So then, don't be afraid. I will provide for you and your children.' And he reassured them and spoke kindly to them." The word of the Lord.
Thanks
be to God. So what I'm about to say isn't always true, but it's often true. Both our naivety, but also on the other side, our suspicions toward others and of others arise oftentimes from our own tendencies. It's very unlikely that we even see or realize this on a conscious level, and we certainly don't want to admit this. I had a friend in my early 20s. I was going to Bible school out in Minneapolis, and his wife was also in Bible school. And so us and our spouses got together, and my friend Josh, I learned that he used to skateboard when he was younger, and I used to skateboard. So we both bought skateboards and started skateboarding again for a very short time. And he always had these amazing, fantastic stories of things that he had lived through and been through. And I was always just like, I couldn't believe it. I was just like, that it's incredible that you had these experiences. But then when we started skateboarding together, you know, he really wasn't that good. But every time we were apart, he'd come back and say like, "Oh, I landed this trick." And then he would try it again and not come anywhere close. And I was kind of baffled. I'm like, that's amazing. And Carla said, "You know that he lies a lot, right?" And I didn't. I was really naive. Like, I didn't understand why he would need to lie about these kinds of things. And I didn't really fault him for it. He had an issue. And I still loved him as a friend, but I was a little more aware that sometimes he embellished. And I was naive to that. And then there's another side of things. There's our suspicions. And our suspicions, sometimes we assume others' motivations that are really a little bit closer to the way we might do things than we're ready to admit. For instance, I had another good friend who is very political. And I remember when President Obama's term, his second term, was coming to an end, and he said, "You just wait, he's a dictator. He's going to take over, and he's not going to give up the presidency." And I said, "Trust me, Obama has given up. He's going to go on vacation. That's what he's going to do, because any sane person would." And sure enough, that's what happened. There was, you know, he let it go, and he was done. And then when it came time for his favorite president to be done in office, he was like, not only should he stay there, but he should get an extra 4 years even after that. And I started going, huh, now I see where those thoughts might have came from. But of course, he would have never realized. Sometimes we project. I was like, okay, that might be a lesson from your own playbook. So now when people suggest outlandish things to me, I have to question, are you telling me something about them, or are you telling me something about yourself? This is what is happening with Joseph's brothers. Jacob recently dies, and they're afraid, and they assume that Joseph is going to want to get revenge. Why? Most likely because that's what they would do if they were in his position. So they make up a lie. "Father, before he died," they say, "ask that you would forgive us." They admitted their grievous behavior. You'll see twice they admit that they sinned against Joseph. And then they talk about how they wrongly treated him and treated him badly. Now, it's been 17 years since they've reunited. And when Joseph hears this, and he knows that it wasn't Jacob that said this, he just breaks down in tears. They still don't seem to know who he is. Joseph's life with God teaches us a few things, and one of them is that we don't need to repay. Verse 19, "Don't be afraid. Am I in the place of God?" Though it's been 2,000 years since Jesus has walked the earth, we still live in an eye-for-an-eye kind of world. We still want to see people get their just reward, to get what's coming to them. There's a saying that I've come to love, and I think it's filled with wisdom, and it goes like this: "To forgive is to set a prisoner free and to discover that prisoner was you." Now, we're not even really talking about forgiveness yet. We're talking about not feeling the need to repay, to get even, to take revenge. And this focus, this desire to see that balance, that someone get what they deserve for what they did, is itself a prison to us. There's something freeing about trusting God with the lives of others. Others are indeed to blame for what they've done to us. But as adults, we are responsible for our healing. Joseph's brothers didn't take responsibility for Joseph's healing, even though they're the ones who hurt him. In fact, we can see that they still have their own issues. You know, the person who hurt you probably isn't the person who's going to be able to heal you. Amen? So stop waiting for them to do that. Joseph's life with God and other healthy relationships in his life are what helped heal him. He's married now. He has children. He has friendships. And in those places, he's found his restoration and his healing. The second thing that we learn is that we can trust God to redeem. Verse 20 is that famous verse that we should all remember more regularly. "You intended to harm me, but God intended it for good, to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives." Joseph acknowledges the harm that they inflicted. He doesn't minimize it. But he remembers and he reminds them of an even greater truth. God is actively redeeming the harm that others have done to us. The things that others have inflicted upon us or intended toward us. And this changes everything. No longer do we have to be called victims, but we become victors. Hope for Humanity, a tea shop in Ludington that brings awareness about human trafficking. It was founded by Pastor Carmen, who has preached here multiple times, and a good friend of mine, Chris Turnbull. I love their term for those that they're helping and restoring because of their lives have been impacted by human trafficking. They call them survivors. And I love that they don't call them victims, but they call them survivors, because that rightly changes the emphasis from powerlessness towards strength. Yes, you suffered unjustly, but you survived. Viktor Frankl, he spent 3 years in 4 different concentration camps, including Auschwitz. He says this. He says, when we are no longer able to change a situation, we are challenged to change ourselves. Frankl later went on to write a book that has become very popular, Man's Search for Meaning. And it is all about the ways of thinking that enabled him not only to survive the harsh conditions of the concentration camp, but also to find meaning in life, even in that place, when he couldn't control or change the outward circumstances, but he could decide who he was going to be and where he was going to find meaning, even in the midst of that situation. The scriptures tell us how and where to find meaning. It doesn't just tell us how to survive, but it gives us confidence that God is redeeming even the most broken of situations. And even as he used Frankl to help others to experience hope and to encourage them, over 10 million copies of that book have been sold. And it's not a book that you read for entertainment or for leisure reading. You would only read this book in order to be able to find hope for your own redemption and to find meaning for your own life in the midst of whatever place you find yourself. It's a book that you read toward redemption. God is redeeming our lives, every part. And he's redeeming the lives of others as well, even those who have hurt us. Joseph weeps because he longs for his brother's redemption. Here, he has a chance to explain it to them. He says, don't you see? This is bigger than you. This is bigger than me. What you meant for harm, God used for the good of many. We are not victims, but survivors, if we will allow and trust God's redemptive activity and purposes. Joseph does not minimize or excuse his brother's actions. Instead, he glorifies God's redemptive work. God is constantly redeeming the sins of humanity for our sake. His work through Christ is the ultimate example of this. Our sin and our violence is what put Christ to death. But Christ's life, his death, his resurrection saves and redeems us for all eternity. What we meant for evil, God used for our good. It is the gospel story again and again and again. And so finally, we know that God will restore. Not everything will be made right in this life. Just as God's ultimate promise to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob was not fulfilled in their lifetime. As we come to the end of Genesis, our vision is reset toward this ultimate fulfillment. The promise that one day they will return to the land. Let's go ahead and continue reading verse 22 to 26. Joseph stayed in Egypt along with all his father's family. He lived 110 years and saw the third generation of Ephraim's children. Also the children of Machir, son of Manasseh, were placed at birth on Joseph's knees. Then Joseph said to his brothers, I am about to die, but God will surely come to your aid and take you up out of this land to the land he promised on oath to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And Joseph made the sons of Israel swear on an oath and said, God will surely come to your aid, and then you must carry my bones up from this place. So Joseph died at the age of 110, and after they embalmed him, he was placed in a coffin in Egypt. So for that current time, Egypt was their salvation. But of course, there would be a greater promise, a greater salvation to come. Joseph prophetically declares and symbolizes this by having the people swear on an oath that they will return his bones to the promised land when God would ultimately lead his people back. In this life, God is actively redeeming all things. And this is a slow and often hidden process. And as we remember this, we're able to give grace to ourselves and to others. The ultimate hope is what really keeps us, and it echoes here in this final passage and promise in Genesis. But this promise will happen for us at an even greater level. One day, God will restore all things, Scripture tells us. And this is where we connect the promise of the first book of Genesis with the ultimate promise of the last book of the Bible in Revelation. Revelation 21, 1 to 5 says this, "Behold, I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Now the dwelling of God is with men, and he will live with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away.' He who was seated on the throne said, 'Behold, I am making everything new.'" Our salvation in this life is to walk with Christ. Our ultimate salvation is to be reunited with him face to face in the new creation that he is bringing about, because he is indeed redeeming all things. This is our hope. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this hope that indeed sustains us. Help us not to lose sight of it, for it is what enables us to be survivors and overcomers in this life. It is what enables us to be able to forgive ourselves and also forgive others and give grace to them and entrust their lives to you. I pray that if there is anyone that is here today who not only has been hurt but has been held in bitterness, waiting the repayments of the one who has hurt them, that today they will receive the invitation by the Spirit to let go and to trust this other person's life to you as they continue to build the life that you have for them without hindrance, knowing the plans that you have for them, which indeed are to prosper them. And though we will not be without challenge or struggle, we'll also not be without you, which means we always have hope. So help us to remove all hindrances, including hate, including bitterness, including wanting to repay. As we trust our life to you, help us to trust others' lives to you, and help us to look forward to what you've already done and what you are about to do, and to believe that Christ holds us and will indeed bring us to himself. For this is the hope and the glory of God and the promise to his saints. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And Sue, if you would come and lead us in a song of response.